Right. Sounds like it's on. You can hear me. Good morning, everyone. Good to see you all this morning. I thought that I might have scared you away last week, but I'm glad to see you're back. It was a little bit of a lengthy presentation. We unpacked a lot of history together, but today we're going to carry on looking at this subject. I'm going to start with a bit of history. So if you happen to have not been here last week, you won't miss out on too much. You'll get the gist of it, although you won't get all the weight of the evidence, as it were, because that would require an hour to go over last week's presentation. So what we're going to do today is carry on with our series, which is entitled The Appointment. And we've been looking every week for this is the fourth week, we've been looking at the Sabbath as it is revealed in Scripture. And so given that we are able to go on for 4 weeks and next week, which is 5 weeks, and if you allowed me to, I'd go on for a sixth week. Given that you can do that, you realize that the Sabbath is actually a major theme in Scripture, right? It flows all the way from Genesis through to Revelation. And that's actually where we're going to spend our time this morning. We're going to be looking at the book of Revelation a little bit, and we're going to be unpacking the Sabbath as it will unfold itself in the near future. So my disclaimer last week was that there was a lot of history. My disclaimer this week is that we're now delving into the area of prophecy. Now, what does that mean? That means that we're going to start to touch on things that assumes a certain amount of knowledge. So if you have never looked at Bible prophecy, if you're not well-versed in the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation, that's all right. But just hang in there. If there are some things I mention and you're thinking, I've never heard that before, or I don't know how you come to that conclusion, I will provide for you the basic gist of it, but in order to actually present this topic, I almost need an entire session with you before this topic, just going through some principles of Bible prophecy, all right? So I'm going to assume a certain amount of knowledge. If you are interested in this, you don't know much about it, and you'd like to know more, please know that there are a number of us in the congregation that would be happy to study this with you one-on-one in your own lounge or as a family or however you want to do it, right? There's myself, there's our Bible worker Jordan, there's any one of our elders, all well-versed in these subjects, and we would be more than happy to get into it with you in more detail. So that's actually a personal invitation, right? If you want to know more, speak to me. And we're only too happy to go into it in more depth. So do you understand my little disclaimer this morning as I begin? There's a lot that we're going to be talking about. I don't have time to study out the finest detail of every aspect, but we're going to stick to the theme of the Sabbath. Does that make sense? All right. There's also going to be some things this morning that are going to be challenging for you to hear. And that kind of makes sense, because when you talk about Bible prophecy, you're talking about messages that God has given to a generation living at the end, preparing for the coming of Jesus. And often in those messages, all the prophets throughout Scripture did not prophesy smooth things. They prophesied wake-up messages. They prophesied messages that called people to repentance. They laid truth before people, truth that had gotten lost in the sands of time and in the deceptions of the enemy and so on. So we're going to be unpacking some of those things this morning. So for obvious reasons, I'm going to invite you just to bow your heads, remain seated as I pray one more time up here. Father in heaven, this morning is another challenging topic. It's challenging to present. It's challenging to hear. And I just ask, Lord, that you will give me the ability to communicate it in a way that is simple, in a way that's credible and clear. And I pray for the hearers of this presentation that your Holy Spirit will do what your Holy Spirit can do, has to do by himself, which is the conviction part, which is really making these words come to life in the hearer's mind and heart. So, Lord, in the midst of all of it, we pray that we would see you clearly, and we pray that we would understand the teachings of your word. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Right. In the near future. Well, in the past, many wars have been fought. They continue to be fought today. And fundamentally, just about every war comes down to this principle: authority. Who has the right to rule? Two warring parties disagree on who has the authority to rule in that territory and why they have the authority to rule in that territory. Wars of revolution are typically wars where a native people overthrows some conquering empire, like the British colonists or that kind of thing, right? Wars of revolution in the United States, late 1700s, that's exactly what happened. The United States were originally British colonies, much like New Zealand and Australia and South Africa and various other places. And eventually the colonists colonists that had moved there decided that they no longer wanted to be taxed. They didn't want to be under the authority of the kings and the queens of England. And so there was a war of revolution. People died for their freedom. People died to have their autonomy. And autonomy is just another word for authority, right? The right to rule themselves. A few decades later, only a few decades later, that was the late 1700s, a few decades later, the authority question turned in on itself in those American states, and they broke into what was known as the Civil War. The Civil War cost more lives than America's involvement in World War I and II combined. Did you know that? People died arguing with each other within the same territories as to who should have the right to rule, under whose authority should the government be formed. And I want to suggest to you, after everything I've shared with you over the last 3 weeks and now the fourth, that the Sabbath is exactly that question in a spiritual sense. The Sabbath represents the question of authority over the human heart. Who has the right to rule, man or God? Who has the right to make the laws that supersede all other laws, man or God? Who stands in the highest place, man or God? And what I'm going to demonstrate to you today as we study Bible prophecy, I've implied it through the study of history last week, but this week as we unpack prophecy, we're going to see that that is the key thing why the Sabbath becomes so important in the last days. Why it has always been important, but why in the last days it becomes especially important. Now, a few years ago, not long ago, 2014 I think it was, a man by the name of Tony Palmer spoke these words. He was addressing a congregation in a live sermon. He was speaking about the differences between Catholicism and Protestantism, this thing that was called the Reformation or the Protestant Reformation. By the way, you know why everything that is not Roman Catholic is called Protestant? Because a Protestant is simply one who protests. It is the Protestant, Protestant. We pronounce it differently, but that's what it is. A Protestant is a Protestant, right? And that originated around the 1500s, maybe a touch earlier, but it broke into full fruition with the Protestant Reformation in the 1500s, 1600s, and onwards. Men like Martin Luther and John Calvin and Jerome and Huss and Zwingli and all these names you may or may not be familiar with. Did you know that this year, 2017, is 500 years. It is the 500th anniversary this year of what is considered the official birth of the Protestant Reformation. 500 years, five centuries of the Reformation. So in connection with the Reformation, Tony Palmer said this in his sermon, "Brothers and sisters, Luther's protest is over, is yours." The protest has been over for 15 years. He was referring to a document that was signed in 1999, I think it was, 1999, between the Lutheran Protestant Church and the Roman Catholic Church, which was basically a statement and a declaration, a joint understanding of how you were saved. And this document allegedly buries the differences between Martin Luther's basis for his reform when it comes to the doctrine of salvation and Catholicism's difference from that protesting. He says after this, he says, "I get a bit cheeky here because I challenge my Protestant pastor friends. If there's no more protest, how can there be a Protestant church? Maybe now we're all Catholics again." He said this kind of tongue-in-cheek if you watch the video. "But we're reformed. We're Catholic in the universal sense," because that's what the word Catholic actually means, right? Catholic simply means worldwide or universal. "We are not protesting the doctrine of salvation by the Catholic Church anymore. We now preach the same gospel. We now preach you are saved by grace through faith alone. The protest is over. The protest is over." And I am going to respectfully disagree with this principle. And here's why. Because I'm going to demonstrate to you that the Protestant Reformation was about a whole lot more than only the teaching of salvation. The Protestant Reformation split the church over the question of authority fundamentally, and that has not changed. The wording of how, what we view about salvation may have changed on the Catholic side or on the Lutheran side or whichever side. You can get into that debate at another time. But the fundamental principle runs far deeper than only the doctrine of salvation. I don't believe that the Protestant Reformation is over at all. I believe that you and I today are still continuing the line of the Protestant Reformation. Now, let's be clear about this. The Reformation, the word, simply means to reform. So in other words, Jesus Christ started something pure, original, and right. Somewhere along the line over the eons of time, like we studied last week, that pure, right thing became muddied and dirtied and deformed. And so the Protestant Reformation set about reforming what was once pure and true and whole that now had become apostate. They wanted to reform it. So really, the Protestant Reformation should go on to the end of time, right? Because all of our lives should be the quest for greater wholeness in the Word of God. All of our lives, we should be seeking the areas that God would have us reform in regards to, right? So, I'm going to argue that the Protestant Reformation did not end with the Reformers, that you and I today are a continuation of that Protestant generation. So let's go back in time to the Council of Trent. Happened over a number of years, 1545 to 1563. Multiple sessions, bishops and clerics and priests and all sorts of people gathered in this town called, guess what? Trent. Okay. Hence the Council of Trent. And they convened because of the Protestant Reformation. Now, 1530, the Augsburg Confession was adopted. You, like I said last week, you don't need to remember the dates. You don't need to remember the names. Just follow the narrative. Follow the story. In 1530, the Augsburg Confession was adopted, which was basically a description to the kings of Europe as to the ways in which the Protestant reformers differed from Roman Catholicism. Are you with me? Now, in 1530, so that's kind of like an official document for the Protestants. A few years later, 15 years later, the Council of Trent starts. Do you follow? You're following the timeline. They convened the council for one reason. Well, that's not entirely true. Multiple reasons, but one central reason. They needed to figure out what to do with the Protestant Reformation. And so as in ages past, all the people, all the key leaders, the decision makers were called together into one place and they discussed this thing called the Reformation. They discussed the basis for the Reformation. And here's what they found out. The Reformation, they discovered, and they knew, was based on the idea that the Roman Catholic Church was basing its authority for teaching and doctrine and practice on the Bible in combination with church tradition. Official church tradition that was handed down, they say, from pope to pope, from council to council, and they said that this church tradition is as weighty as the Bible. That the church, in essence, is the voice of Christ, and therefore, when the church in its combined councils, through its official resources, makes a declaration, makes a decree, comes up with a teaching, that then becomes a part, even if it contradicts Scripture, the church has the authority to override Scripture in the modern age, because that's the authority that Christ himself has given. The Protestants said, no, that could lead us anywhere, we don't want that. And so they said, the Bible and the Bible alone. Are you with me? So when the Council of Trent met, this was their discussion. Now here's the interesting bit. Of all the priests, the bishops, the cardinals, and everyone that attended there, there was a major division within Catholicism at that moment in time over this key central teaching of Protestantism. The Catholic Church, embodied by these leaders, was divided over whether to go with the Reformation principle or to stick with their history. Are you with me? You hear what I'm saying so far? They were so deadlocked that they were stuck. They could not take a vote, a clear majority vote on the subject for days and days and days. People went backwards and forwards on the subject. And these priests, these Roman Catholic priests, couldn't decide. Eventually, the Archbishop of Reggio walks into the room and he addresses the people, the delegates at the council. And the Archbishop of Reggio refutes the Protestant Reformation principle of the Bible and the Bible alone based on Protestant practice and inconsistency. Here's what he says, and this is what swayed the decision. The Protestants claim to stand upon the written word only. They justify their revolt, in other words, their breaking away from the Roman Catholic Church. They justify their revolt by the plea that the church has apostatized from the written word and follows tradition. Their profession of holding the scriptures alone as the standard of faith is false. Proof, he says. The written word explicitly enjoins the observance of the seventh day as the Sabbath. Yet they not only reject the observance of the Sabbath enjoined in the written word, but they have adopted and do practice the observance of Sunday, for which they have only the tradition of the church. Consequently, the claim of Scripture alone as the standard fails, and the doctrine of Scripture and tradition as essential is fully established, the Protestants themselves being the judges. After this, the vote was taken and the Roman Catholic Church sealed its direction as a church of tradition and as a church of extra-biblical authority outside of the Scriptures. Does that make sense to you? Now, here's the thing. When I read this, it blew my mind. I thought to myself, how close, how different would history be today if this Roman Catholic Church Council had made the decision to accept the Protestant principle? And you know what the precipitating factor is that drove them in the other direction? That Protestants themselves were inconsistent in the question of Sabbath keeping. And so they used that as the evidence to say, but although they talk a good game, when it comes to the actual practice, even Protestants themselves accept church tradition as authoritative over and above the Word of God. So if they don't even practice their own principles, how can we as a Roman Catholic Church agree to adopt their principles? Now, let's be clear about something. Had it not been the Sabbath issue, it may have been some other issue. Does that make sense? I don't know how history would have unfolded, but it boggles my mind to think that maybe, possibly, at that moment, God Himself was working to shift the direction of Roman Catholicism back to the Word. The greatest moment in the Reformation would have been the repentance of the Roman Catholic Church institution. But it failed. And so here we are. And here's the Augsburg Confession. Because it was necessary to appoint a certain day that the people might know when they ought to come together, it appears that the church designated the Lord's Day for this purpose. The very inception of the Protestant Reformation, the Augsburg Confession, recognized that the Sabbath was the seventh day according to Scripture, but Sunday according to church tradition. So Protestants and Catholics were wholeheartedly in agreement on this subject at the inception of the Reformation. Did you get that? Now let's be clear. When you read the Augsburg Confession, while they accept the Sunday, they argue with Catholicism over the way in which Catholicism regards all church festivals, including Sunday and all other rites, as meritorious and as addition to what Christ has done. So the Augsburg Confession, the part that they're seeking reformation on the Sabbath question, is they're saying, we acknowledge that the Sunday, they're not looking for reformation in the day that's chosen. They're looking for reformation only in recognizing that you shouldn't have to be considered as a sinner if you don't show up at church on Sunday. That was their idea of Sabbath reform. Does that make sense? The church was saying, if you're not taking the sacraments, if you don't come to church, etc., then those things stand against you as sin and you may be lost. The Augsburg Confession is saying, we know it's a church tradition, but it shouldn't be regarded as something which determines your salvation. Now, that last little bit, by the way, I actually agree with. Nothing can add to your salvation in terms of what Christ has done. His sacrifice, His atonement is all sufficient in every capacity. You add nothing to what Jesus Christ has done. The Sabbath and any other question of obedience has nothing to do with earning your salvation or making you appear righteous before God. It is always the fruit of being reconciled with God. In the context of a reconciled relationship with Christ, we are brought into harmony with Him and our lives demonstrate the living fruit of living connection with the living Christ. Does that make sense? So there's an element of the Augsburg Confession I want to agree with as a Protestant, but the part that I'm challenged by is the Reformation didn't go far enough on that particular question. So the key divide between Protestant and Catholic faith in the early days and still today is this question of authority. The Bible alone, which the watchword in the Latin was sola scriptura, the Bible and the Bible alone, or the Bible plus church tradition. So, have a look at this quote here. This is a beauty, by the way. This comes straight off of the Vatican website today. You hear what I'm saying? This is not some ancient document. listen to it. You will hear the exact issue of the Reformation and the question of the Council of Trent echoed in the statement. So the Catechism of the Catholic Church on the Vatican website says, the task of interpreting the Word of God authentically has been entrusted, what? Solely to the magisterium of the Church, meaning the Roman Catholic Church. That is, to the Pope and to the bishops in communion with him. What is it saying? It's saying you and I have no authority, no right, and are incapable of understanding the Word in all its truth. You must get approval for what you think the Word is saying through the official avenue of the Church. They are the definitive teachers and interpreters of the Word of God, which is precisely what the Protestant Reformation was about undoing. Right? That's why the Bible was printed in the language of the common people and disseminated to the common person. That's what fueled the Reformation. Suddenly the common person had access to the Word of God and they started to go, wait a second, this is so radically different to what goes on a Sunday morning at church. And there was this movement away from traditional Roman Catholicism. This statement, which is extant today on the Vatican website, echoes Pope Paul VI when he said in 1965, the task of authentically interpreting the Word of God, whether written or handed on, has been entrusted exclusively to the living teaching office of the Church, whose authority is exercised in the name of Jesus Christ. And that's why in the 1700s, one of the most well-known theologians of all time speaks these words, which are still the idea today, that in the new law, the observance of the Lord's Day, that's referring to Sunday, took the place of observance of the Sabbath, not by virtue of the precept, but by the institution of the Church and the custom. Did you hear that word custom? That means tradition, right? That means habit. That means a practice which over time has become so common that it is now normal, right? So by the authority of the Church and the custom of Christian people. That's Thomas Aquinas in his big work, Summa Theologica. So this is kind of what we were looking at in more detail last week, just bringing the bits and the pieces together so you understand, A, what was the Reformation about? It wasn't just only about the teaching of salvation. It was more fundamental to that. Below all your doctrines is your view of epistemology. That's a fancy word for the source of your knowledge. Where do you derive knowledge from? What is reliable as truth? That is the question of authority, right? How do you determine between two different opinions? Where do you go with these opposing arguments to the definitive arbiter of truth? Protestants are going the Bible and the Bible alone. The Catholic Church is going the Bible through the Church with our traditions. We are the only ones that can interpret the Bible rightly. We have the authority of Christ. We speak as the voice of Christ. We have the right to overrule, to change and to alter, to suit present circumstances, the authority, the traditions of the Church and the customs of people. And the Sabbath, of course, is caught up in the middle of that. When you read the Roman Catholic Catechism, which, of course, is a teaching book, the question is asked, by what authority did the Church substitute Sunday for Saturday? And the simple answer, very straightforward answer, is the Church substituted Sunday for Saturday by the plenitude, that means the abundance, of that divine power which Jesus Christ bestowed on her. And one more before I make the point. Of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change was her act. And the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. Now, when I was first introduced to this idea, when I first came across this idea, I must admit I was puzzled. I was puzzled by why it is so easy to find so much clear evidence that the Sabbath was changed from Saturday to Sunday. Now think about it. You see, because I'm thinking as a Protestant, I'm thinking about the Word of God. I'm thinking to myself, it's shameful to change the Word of God. Right? If I was going to change the Word of God, I would do my best to make sure you could never track it back to me. Right? And so it bothered me for such a long time. Why are they so open about it? Why do they acknowledge it? Why is it in their official sources, in their modern publications, in their ancient publications, their major theologians, their priests, the popes, the last three popes have openly acknowledged, and that's just a continuation from previous popes, that the Sunday is in fact the institution of the Church. You do not have to look far to find this. And I couldn't understand. Why is it so blatant? Why is it so obvious? Until I read some of these statements. What are they saying? They're saying, we are not even trying to hide it. And you know why we are not even trying to hide it? Because we're the boss. We don't have to hide it. We don't have to apologize for it. We are the divine church of Jesus Christ. We speak for Christ on earth. So if we make a change, it's not a sin. It's not something that's a shameful thing to do. We actually have the right to change it. That's their argument. And so instead of the Sabbath being a hidden, dirty little secret that they're trying to cover up, the change of the Sabbath, it's worn as a badge of honor. It is a symbol of their spiritual authority. You heard what that statement said, right? A mark of our ecclesiastical power and authority. The Sabbath is the badge we wear that says we have all spiritual authority on earth. I mean, if we can change the very Ten Commandments of God, of course they would argue by His authority, although they themselves say by the custom of Christian people, right? If you believe you have the right to do that, then you would be quite proud of it, wouldn't you? You'd just be like, yeah, so what? I can do that, right? So this is important to understand. This is why it's easy to find evidence on the subject. Louis Gaston Segur, a bishop in France many years ago, wrote these words in his book, Plain Talk About Protestantism of Today, 1874 is when it was written, page 213. He says, thus the observance of Sunday by the Protestants is a homage they pay, in spite of themselves, to the authority of the Catholic Church. Let me unpack that for you. The Protestants said, the Bible and the Bible alone. We are not going to be a part of an apostate church that it does not believe in the Bible and the Bible alone. Yet the Augsburg Confession, the very foundation of Protestantism, acknowledged that the Sunday is what? A church tradition, right? So what he's saying here is Protestants can pride themselves on being separated from the Roman Catholic apostate church all they want. But as long as they keep the very mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority, the very evidence that she has the power to change the very laws of God, to take the place of the divine lawgiver on earth, as it were, then as long as they are honoring the Sunday, the Roman Catholicism says, you're actually just part of our family. you're saying we don't recognize church tradition as authoritative, we don't recognize the Pope as the head of Christianity, and yet the very act of worship called Sunday is their sign, their change, their ecclesiastical power and authority. And so he's going and saying, despite themselves, despite what they say, they talk a good game, but as long as Sunday remains their day of chosen worship, they can only trace that back to our power and authority. Sounds like a civil war, doesn't it? Sounds like a war of revolution. We started off by saying that people will die for their freedom. They will die for the right authority. And Catholicism, in essence, is saying, say what you like, but as long as you wear our badge, you're under our authority. You recognize us. Now, let's come to the Bible. So that's all the history stuff, right? Let's come to the Bible. That's what we want to talk about. Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 to 7. There are three angels in Revelation 14. We call it the, guess what? Three angels' messages, all right? And we're only going to unpack the first angel briefly this morning. And that's found in verses 6 and 7, and it says this. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, so here comes the message, fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come. And worship Him who made heaven and earth, the sea, and the springs of water. What you need to know about the first angel's message is, number one, it speaks to an end time generation. Number two, it calls for worship reform. Do I need to go back so that you can see it again? Right? Have a look at it. Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come. And do what? Worship Him. Who is Him? The one who is the Creator. That's why the rest of the phrase is, worship Him who made what? The heavens, the earth, the sea, and the fountains of water, right? Worship Him who made. So the first angel's message at its core is a call to a last day generation, I'll come back to that point in a moment, that says, God wants you to repent and return to worship the true God. How do you know who the true God is? He's the one who creates, who makes, who brings into existence. That is the key differentiating factor between the creator and the creature. The creature does not create. We might procreate, but we do not create original life outside of our own species. God speaks worlds into existence. He breathes life into clay nostrils and is brought into existence. The difference, the reason why we worship God is because we owe everything to Him. He is not a being equal to us. He's not your mate that you put your arm around and look in the eyes. Now, of course, I know that Jesus comes to demonstrate that He is a part of our family, but in the core concept of what is God compared to us, God is the completely other. God is the one who is above and beyond. He is the one who gives life, the author of life. We are the ones who borrow life. And because of that, we worship Him. Because without Him, there just would be no us. So we kind of owe loyalty, respect, reverence to Him. We kind of have to see Him as superior, above and beyond. See, I won't worship you because you are my equal. And you better not worship me because I am your equal and a sinner. But God is altogether different. So the first angel's message appeals to a generation in the last days going, worship the one who is the creator, the one who is worthy of your loyalty, your admiration, and your gratitude. Right. How do I know this is specifically an end time generation, not a message for all generations? Very simply because he says in there, the hour of his judgment has come. That means it is present tense. And this is speaking about before the coming of Jesus, because when you follow the book of Revelation, Jesus hasn't come at this point in Revelation so far. So an hour of judgment begins before Jesus returns. There is only one place that foretells a judgment yet future and yet before the coming of Jesus, and that's in Daniel chapter 8. Now again, this is what I said to you earlier on. I don't have time to study this out in detail with you this morning, except to say, in Daniel 8, hundreds of years before Christ comes, the prophet Daniel says, in 2,300 years from a particular starting point, there shall be a judgment called the cleansing of the sanctuary, etc., etc., right? In the book of Revelation, that judgment is no longer future, but is declared to be a present reality. Does that make sense? And when you take Daniel 8 and you work it out according to the rules of Bible prophecy, you'll find that it counts down to the 1800s. 1844 is when the hour of his judgment would begin. So when this angel comes along and he says to a group of people, which group of people? I don't know. The hour of his judgment has come. We know he's not talking about the time of the apostles. He's not talking about the time of Daniel. He's not talking about the Middle Ages. He's not even talking about the era where the Reformation begins. He's talking about when, after the judgment has begun. The 1800s and beyond is relevant to the first angel's message. Where are we in the stream of time right now? What's our year? 2017, more or less, right? We are living in the hour of his judgment. We are almost 200 odd years into this time period of the first angel. And the message for this generation is a message that calls us to worship reform. It is a message that calls us back to loyalty to the Creator God. Hey, do you know what else was born in 1844? There's an interesting book published in 1844. Undermined the creation story. Charles Darwin's Origin of the Species. Isn't that just bizarre? It's just, you'd almost say it was coincidence. No. Right? This idea that in this particular era, we are called to worship the Creator at a time when creation itself is attacked and undermined by so-called science. It's like the Bible is saying, it's like God is saying, I actually know what's going to happen. And I'm warning you, a message relevant to this age, remember the Creator. Worship the Creator. Now, there's a very interesting phrase in there. When you go to Exodus chapter 20, verse 11, now 8 to 11 is a Sabbath commandment, right? Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, neither you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your manservant, nor your female servant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, nor the stranger that is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. Verse 11, when you compare it to Revelation 14, verse 7, has a direct quote. Revelation 14, 7 says, "Worship him who made the heavens and the earth, the sea." And Exodus 20, verse 11 says, "For the Lord God made the heavens, the earth, and the sea." What are we saying? We're saying something very simple. If the last generation of people living in the hour of his judgment have a tailor-made message that calls them back to fear God, give glory to him, because you're living in the hour of his judgment, and make sure you are worshiping the true God, identified as the Creator God, then it makes perfect sense that if the Sabbath of the commandment is an evidence of the Creator God, the very basis for the giving of the law in Exodus 20, verse 8 to 11, to remember the seventh day to keep it holy, is because of the example of God at creation, right? At the end of telling you what the Sabbath is, when it is, how you should observe it in brief, he simply says, "For, because." Why is the command there? "For the Lord made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. He made them in 6 days. He rested on the seventh. So you imitate him as your heavenly Father. You come into his space of time called the Sabbath on the same terms that he gave the Sabbath." Now, of course, we spent a whole session just looking at the creation account, so I'm not going to go into all of that. I'm just going to say that in the book of Revelation, the message to this generation is very simple. Worship the Creator God, and if the Sabbath is the very symbol of the Creator God, then it makes perfect sense that implied in the appeal to come back to the Creator God is also an appeal to continue the Reformation, particularly in the area of reforming the seventh day Sabbath. Does that make sense to you? How would you worship the Creator God, but exclude the very time, the very means by which he has said, "This is how you acknowledge me as the Creator God"? You wouldn't, right? If he's the Creator God, and you worship him as the Creator God, then you will worship him according to his description of the symbolism of the Creator God, which includes the seventh-day Sabbath. So the first angel's message overtly calls us to reform in the area of loyalty and worship, calling us back to the Creator God, and it implies that along with that loyalty to the Creator God, we will also reform in the day of worship, to come back to the Word of God, to come back to the very symbol of the creation event itself, the symbol that we stand under loyalty to the Creator God. Now, here's where we start going a little bit quickly. Revelation 13. Revelation 13 is a powerful chapter, and there's a lot in it. So let's back it up. Revelation 14, which is where we were, starts with a picture of heaven. It's what is known as the 144,000, and I'm not even going to go there with you today. But there is a group in Revelation chapter 1, 14, verse 1 to 5. It's a picture of heaven, and it's a picture of victory. After that, for the rest of chapter 14, the gaze shifts from heaven and final victory back to earth in the final conflict. In that final conflict, the rest of chapter 14 is about what God's people are doing and saying. It is the message of the three angels, one of which we've just unpacked very briefly, right? When you back it up and you go to Revelation chapter 13, you're going to find an entire chapter there that covers exactly the same time period of history, but it is a perspective of what the godless are doing, what the counterfeit religious system is doing. Remember, there is a great controversy that rages between Christ and Satan. You and I are in the final line of this world's heritage, of that battle. We are in the midst of this great controversy, right? It's not something that was limited to the people of Bible times. You and I today, every choice we make, every aspect of our lives is demonstrating under whose banner ultimately we will make our final stand, right? The great controversy between Christ and Satan. In Revelation 13 and 14, depicts that controversy between Satan and his allies, and Christ and his allies, with a picture in the middle of that, of those two descriptions of final victory. And this is why. Because at the end of Revelation 13, the picture looks so dire, the picture looks so terrible, that before he goes on to tell you about what the righteous are doing in the midst of what the wicked are doing, he says, let me just reassure you by giving you a picture that, as horrible as it seems, there will be those who gain the victory. So you shift to heaven, you catch a picture of heaven, and then you come back down to the controversy. Does that make sense to you? Now, when you get to Revelation chapter 13, don't have time to read it all with you. I encourage you to read it this afternoon. There are two or three major game players here. One is a dragon. One is a sea beast. It comes up out of the sea. And one is a land beast. Now, here's what you need to know about Bible prophecy. Bible prophecy tells you truth through symbols. The message is absolutely true and reliable. The tricky bit is making sure you've got the right key to unlock the symbols. Does that make sense? Now, if you follow one simple rule, it'll be very hard to go wrong. The Bible gives you the meaning for the symbols that it employs. If you are reading into the symbol some contemporary thing, something that makes sense in our day and age, then the meaning of prophecy is going to shift from generation to generation. Does that make sense? The Bible will give you a symbol, and then somewhere else it will give you the code that unlocks the symbol. Now, very simple. An example of this is all the way through Daniel chapter 7 and 8 for that matter, there are animals known as beasts. So I want you to understand this. The word beast in Bible prophecy is not a derogatory term. It's not some sensationalistic Hollywood thing. Because often when people read beast, they think of monster. They think of something sinister and evil. But a beast is simply an animal in Bible prophecy. And anytime you encounter an animal in Bible prophecy, Daniel 7 tells you what it is. A beast or an animal represents a political power, an institution of political origin. Does that make sense to you? So that's just one example of how you're going to handle dealing with the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation. So when you read about a beast that comes up out of the water, you need to know what the water is. And then you know that a beast is a political power that arises out of something that water symbolizes. Does that make sense? And so you go through prophecy and make sense of it. Now, I'm not going to go through all of that with you because I don't have the time to take you to all the verses. But very simply, when you scan through Revelation 13, you will find that there is a counterfeit Godhead. You know, the Bible, there is this idea of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, right? In Revelation 13, you find a counterfeit Father, the dragon, a counterfeit Son, the sea beast, who dies and is resurrected, just like Jesus, and a counterfeit Holy Spirit, known as the land beast, or the beast that comes up out of the earth. And he is like a counterfeit Holy Spirit because he also calls fire down from heaven, similar to the day of Pentecost. He also works signs and miracles with an intention to deceive, just like signs and miracles were used by Jesus and the apostles in the beginning as verification of the gospel and of truth. Does that make sense? So when you go through Revelation 13, you have a counterfeit of the plan of salvation. Some other entity dies and is resurrected. You have a counterfeit of the Godhead. You have a counterfeit of the commandments. When you go through the Ten Commandments, the first four govern our relationship with God, right? Who we worship, only God, no statues and images, do not take his name in vain, and the Sabbath day. And when you go through Revelation 13, you find that those commandments, in the context of a counterfeit Godhead, are subverted. He causes all, both rich and poor, to worship something other than God. He blasphemes the name of God, right? That's the third commandment. He goes on to say that he sets up an image to the beast for the purpose of worship. That's the second commandment. When you go through Revelation 13, counterfeit Godhead, counterfeit salvation, counterfeit worship, counterfeit commandments, and counterfeit spiritual power. Fire from heaven, false miracles, so on and so forth. So Revelation 13 is all about the alternative to Revelation 14's appeal to worship the Creator God. In contrast to the righteous who are going, we worship the Creator God, symbolized by Seventh-day Sabbath, there is a group also claiming to be spiritual, also claiming to worship. These are not atheists. In the book of Revelation, there are no atheists in the last days. Everyone's got some spiritual orientation. The final struggle is not between atheism and Christianity. It's between true Christianity, the Word of God Christianity, and counterfeit Christianity, which is Christianity based on the Word of God and tradition. It's the Protestant Reformation, the principles of the Protestant Reformation, that's a question in Revelations 13 and 14, right? So, at the end of the chapter, we read these verses. This is Revelation 13, 15 to 18. It says, "He," this is the beast, was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name." Too much in there to unpack now. So all I'm going to say is this. At the end of the chapter, just before we get a picture of final victory, there is this dire picture of the condition of the world. Counterfeit spirituality led by a counterfeit Godhead with an alternative plan of salvation, with their own commandments in opposition to the commandments of God, have set up a system to which they expect all who claim to be believers to yield in worship to. Does that make sense to you? That's what it says, right? And if you don't agree, if you will not give your loyalty to anything other than the true created God, if you will not go along with this alternative system, then force will be brought to bear. Ultimately a death decree, but before a death decree, you won't be able to buy or sell. You'll be excluded from economic endeavor, whether that's work or whether that's, you know, whatever it is. The pressure, we do that today, by the way. You know that political giants of the world, when they don't like what another country's done, what's the first thing they do? Economic sanctions. So that what happens on a macro political scale, in essence, filters down in its strategy to everyone who will not go along with the system. Now, here's something you need to know. Down through the ages, wherever the true church of God has lost spiritual power and authority, as in, you know, the Holy Spirit, right? Whenever the Holy Spirit seems to become inactive in the life of the church, tradition becomes entrenched, and force becomes the go-to method for getting people to conform. Does that make sense? Where you have the moving of the true Holy Spirit, you have the spirit of persuasion. You have the spirit of tolerance, because God will not compel the conscience of anyone. Everyone has a right to choose for themselves, and not even He will override that. That's what you see in the early church. The power of the Holy Spirit persuades people. The church is not running around with a sword threatening people. But as the church lost the Spirit, as it declined into death and decay and apostasy, in proportion to that, in proportion to the loss of the Spirit, increased tradition, increased ceremony, and increased coercion, persecution, and force. And Revelation 13, in essence, depicts that before Jesus comes in final glory to redeem His children, before Jesus comes, there will be one more final wave of worldwide persecution against true believers. Are we there yet? No. That's why this is called prophecy and not history. Right? Last week was history. This week is prophecy. So if you're sitting in your chair going, "Adrian, you're telling me that in a day and age like ours, which is all about religious tolerance, which is all about being politically correct, which is all about, hey, mate, if it's good for you, it's good for you. Don't mess with me, you know, just leave me alone. I'll do my own thing." You're saying in a day and age like this, you're prophesying that we're going to leave the age of toleration and head back into what is essentially the equivalent of a last day's Middle Ages. Yes. That's exactly what I'm saying. And by the way, look around you in the world today and you will see that the age of toleration is fast evaporating. The fears of security and terrorism and all of that are little waymarks, if you like. We can see the trends. We can see the kinds of people that are getting elected to power these days. And it's not really the, shall we call it, the logical, sane, well-educated type. It's the, "I will do whatever it takes. I don't care about a constitution or anything else. I will do what it takes to keep you all safe." Do you hear what I'm saying? Think of England, think of the United States. The point that I'm making is you can see the atmosphere is changing. You still live today in an era of toleration and freedom. Thank God, especially in this beautiful country. But I'm telling you, according to Bible prophecy, that we are going to leave that era, just as has happened all the way through history and time. There have been eras of freedom, which have been superseded by persecution and force and intolerance, which have then emerged into eras of freedom again. The only reason we emerged out of the Dark Ages, out of the persecution of the Middle Ages, the only reason we did was because new lands were founded on Protestant principles that denied the authority of a pope and denied the authority of a king or a queen. Do you get what I'm saying to you? It is because of Protestant principles of freedom and toleration that you live in a place that is free and tolerable today. But what we're saying to you is, the Bible prophesies that that will come to an end just before Jesus comes, and we will go into another era of darkness, intolerance, persecution. And at the center of that is the question of loyalty, worship, and authority. Does that make sense to you? Okay, so who is the beast? Very simple. Speak to me afterwards if you don't understand this. In Revelation 13, there are at least these few indicators. The Bible gives us these entities so that we can understand them. Otherwise, there'd be no point to them. Do you agree with that? So it gives us indicators and signs. It describes the entities. It's called a beast, so we know it's a political power. On the other hand, we know that he blasphemes God, which means he has a religious component, a union of church and state. We know that the beast in Revelation 13, it arises out of Rome. It says the dragon gave him his power, his seat, and his authority. And the beast himself is described of body parts that are made up from all the beasts of Daniel 7, the individual beasts of Daniel 7. This beast, when you read his description, he's got the paws of one and the face of another and so on, which means he comes after all those nations represented in Daniel chapter 7 out of the era of Rome. We know that this entity persecutes for what the Bible says in Revelation 13 is 42 months. 42 months times 30 days is 1,260 days. Ezekiel 4 verse 6, Numbers 14:34 tells us a day equals a year. 1,260 days is 1,260 years. A very specific period of history that this entity would rule supreme and would persecute the true followers of God. 1,260 years. We also know that he would get a death blow, one of his heads was mortally wounded, and then would come back to life. Revelation 13's description. We also know that the whole world follows after the beast. That means it's an entity that has worldwide recognition. Kings of the earth and powers that be recognize the leadership, the favorable authority of this entity. And as I said, we know that he blasphemes God. There is only one entity throughout history that fits the description of the beast, and that is the institution of Roman Catholicism. Now, notice how I worded that. What did I say? The institution. I am not talking about the godly, well-meaning, good-intentioned believers that call themselves Roman Catholics. I'm talking about the institution itself that down through the ages has denied the authority of God's word as supreme and has blended with it an alternative system. I'm talking about the institution, the system, the beliefs, the hierarchy, all that kind of stuff. It's not true according to the word of God. And this is the only institution down through the ages, starting in 538 with Emperor Justinian, who made the Pope, in essence, the corrector of heretics and ruler over the head of the church, from 538 right down to 1798, when a certain general named Napoleon was conquering the world. 1,260 years, 538 to 1798. And it gave him a death knell, because with the French Revolution, they decided, you don't need God. And if you don't need God, then who is the Pope? The Pope is nothing. And so they marched on their campaigns into Rome, and they took the Pope captive, and he died in captivity in 1798. The end of the church, the end of the era of persecution. So I'm going to suggest to you, I'll try to give you a little bit in there, very fast, that the beast in Revelation 13 is Roman Catholicism. Now, why have I gone to all that trouble? Because there's something in there that's central to the persecution of the last days. It's called the mark of the beast. Now, let me simplify this to you, because there is so much misinformation around this mark of the beast. I've already said to you, I want to desensationalize the concept of a beast. All a beast is, forget about Hollywood, forget about the way the term arouses feelings or anything. A beast is simply an animal, and an animal in prophecy simply represents a political entity. Are you with me so far? So there's nothing derogatory about the beast. Are you with me? Okay. The next thing I want to do is strip away all the Hollywood movies you've ever seen, all the stuff you've read on the internet, all those videos that go around on Facebook virally about microchips and barcodes and all sorts of technological advances that will be the mark of the beast. Listen to me. The text itself denies that. And here's why. Because it is the mark of the beast. Now, you cannot understand what the mark is if you don't know what the beast is. Because let me say it again. Are you ready for this? This is big stuff. Are you ready? It's the mark of the beast. So people go around making a big deal about what the mark of the beast is, and they haven't interpreted the beast correctly. Are you with me? Now, if it's true what I've said to you from historical record and from scripture, that the beast is Roman Catholicism of the Middle Ages, right? If that's true, then the mark of the beast is not some technological gadget. It's not barcodes and microchips under the skin and all that kind of nonsense. Because the controversy in Revelation chapter 13 is about worship, not technology. Are you with me? The issue is worship. It's a controversy between Christ and his agents and the devil and his agents. And the issue is the loyalty of mankind as manifested in the context of worship. There is a counterfeit Godhead. There are counterfeit commandments, a counterfeit alternative salvation. There is counterfeit spiritual power. And then people want to make the mark of the beast about some technological thing. They've totally misread Revelation 13. Revelation 13, I know I'm saying it a lot because I really need it to sink in. Revelation 13 is about worship. And all that technological stuff is irrelevant to worship. Is it true that technology will be used to control the masses? Of course, it already is. Does that make sense? But technology, while it may be used as a tool, is not about worship. So let me suggest to you that the mark of the beast is whatever Catholicism, the beast, defines as its symbol, as its outward sign of loyalty. We already read some quotes about that. What would that be? What does the beast say is its mark of ecclesiastical power and authority? So let's make this clear. In the book of Revelation, the mark of the beast is number one, the counterfeit of the seal of God. Okay, Ezekiel chapter 9. Come with me quickly. Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 4. Listen to this. He said to him, "Walk through the streets of Jerusalem and put a mark on the foreheads of all who weep and sigh because of the detestable sins being committed in the city." In Ezekiel chapter 9, this word mark is used as a sign of authority and of ownership over God's people. God is going to judge his people in Jerusalem. And so he says to them, here's what I want you to do. Before I go in there with the hand of judgment, I want this, in symbolic, figurative terms, I want this man with the ink pen to go through the city, and I want him to mark the ones who are my people. And who are my people? My people are the ones who are crying and lamenting and mourning over the sins of what's happening in Jerusalem. So to be marked under the authority of God means that you are one who is obedient to the commandments of God, because sin is the transgression of the law. And what is it that makes these people look different to the rebellion of Israel, to the rebellion of Jerusalem? It is the fact that they are mourning sin. They are mourning the widespread, rampant breaking of the commandments of God. And so he says, you go through that city and you mark every single one of them who are living in harmony with my commandments. Every single one of them that are obedient to me, mark them before I come in judgment. Anyone that doesn't have the mark of God on them will be destroyed. Are you with me? When you get to Revelation chapter 7, before 14, right? In Revelation chapter 7, it speaks about those who are sealed in the forehead. It speaks about that 144,000 again. And it says, before the winds of destruction blow on the earth, I want you, he tells the angel, I want you to go through and I want you to seal the servants of the living God in their forehead. And when you see those 144,000 again in chapter 14, it says that they have the name of the Father written in their foreheads. In other words, the saved are those who are loyal to the Creator God. The seal is his sign of ownership, his symbol of authority. They are the ones that have kept his commandments. They are the ones that are living by the word of God and the word of God alone. They are not allowing traditions or anything else to overtake them. Those are the ones who will be sealed by God. And in the book of Revelation, chapter 13, there is a counterfeit copy of what God does to his people by putting his sign of authority and ownership of them. The beast comes along and says, I'm going to put my sign of authority and ownership on those who choose the word of God in combination with tradition. Do you get what I'm saying? So there's two groups of people. Everyone's marked. Some are marked with the seal of God, and others are marked with the mark of the beast. And those are symbolic representations of those who are loyal to God and his commandments, and those who are loyal to another system, still claiming to be religious, but have compromised on the commandments of God. Are you with me so far? So the mark of the beast is the counterfeit of the seal of God. It is the symbol of Catholicism's authority. It centers around worship, and therefore it is irrelevant as a technological phenomenon. So let me read it to you again. What does the beast identify as its mark? Of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change was her act. And the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious things. This makes so much sense when you read Revelation 13 the right way. Because the Sunday question is directly around worship. Does that make sense? Amen. Not barcodes and computer chips under the skin and all that stuff. No. The question is loyalty and worship. So I'm suggesting to you that Revelation 13 and 14, prophesying of the future, says that the Sabbath will again become an issue, a point of special contention in the last days. Now let me be very clear with you. I've said to you that the mark of the beast is the mark of the beast, which is the symbol of Roman Catholicism's power and authority in spiritual things. And I've said to you that I believe the mark of the beast is not a chip, not a technological advance, but in essence, the day of worship being Sunday. What am I saying about Sunday keepers, Protestants and Catholics alike, today? I want to make this point very clear. No Sunday keeper today has the mark of the beast. What did I say? How many Sunday keepers have the mark of the beast today? None. Why do I say that? Because Sunday becomes the mark of the beast in the context of final persecution. Do you hear what I'm saying? When coercion and force are brought to bear to compel the conscience of man against the commandments of God, if then you choose to yield to that force and that compulsion in that context, then you are marked as belonging to that system in opposition to God. Does that make sense? So let me just say this one more time, because I know Seventh-day Adventists get criticized about this all the time. No one has the mark of the beast today. There are Sunday worshipers and there are Sabbath day worshipers. No one has the mark of the beast. But in the context of the final showdown between God and his allies and Satan and his allies, the day of worship will become the outward symbol of your spiritual heart commitment. In the context of that final persecution, which is yet future, Sunday will then become the mark of the beast. Do I need to say it again? You got it. Okay. So, last part of what I want to share with you this morning is, where are we today? I've spoken about what prophecy prophesies about. So where are we in the stream of time? Well, I've already said to you, we are fast leaving the age of toleration and of forbearance. Does that make sense? But we still have the privilege of living in a free age today. Enjoy it while it lasts. Make the most of it while it lasts. Learn to follow the Lord and His commandments today in the age of freedom. People say, oh, well, when it all goes down, then I'll be sure to get on the right boat. Hey, if you don't have the courage to get on the right boat now in the age of freedom, you think you're suddenly going to have the backbone to get on the boat when all the chips are down and everything's against you? No. You don't show up at the Olympics to start training. You train for decades before you get to the Olympics. Does that make sense? So I'm saying to you, make the most of this age of freedom. Learn now in the time of ease to obey the Lord and His commandments. Okay. So here's a few organizations for you. And this is just a very cursory view. There's a lot more that we could say about it. In Europe, there's a group called the European Sunday Alliance. And this is what they say about themselves. The European Sunday Alliance is a network of national Sunday alliances, trade unions, civil society organizations, and what? The union of church and state. Do not miss the language. Sounds very benign. It's almost just in there somewhere. You don't see it, right? We're headed back. I said this to you before. I'll say it to you again. Any era that has combined politics and religion in one system of governance becomes a persecuting power. Because here's the logic. From a church perspective, we have the authority of God. From a civil perspective, we can make laws. Should we not make laws that compel people to honor the true God? Do you see the logic of it? And so when you combine civil power and religious power, you end up with persecution. What's this organization all about? Now, of course, they will tell you that they're all about religious freedom. But here's the definition of religious freedom. Religious freedom, this is not their written definition. This is my interpretation after reading their documents. Religious freedom is using legislation to ensure that people are free to worship in a certain way. But that's the very definition of religious persecution. Does that make sense to you? So, a network of national Sunday alliances, trade unions, civil society. Why trade unions? Because you're trying to compel governments to legislate time off. One of your most powerful allies is going to be trade unions, who can mobilize the workforce to make governments do this, right? Civil society organizations, religious communities, committed to raise awareness of the unique value of, listen to this word, synchronized free time for our European societies. Let me tell you what I would support in legislation. I would support in legislation a curbing of hours of work. I would support in legislation that workers should not be exploited through overwork and that kind of thing. What they're arguing for is we need legislation that compels everyone to be off at exactly the same time. Why would I oppose that? Because that's what Constantine did in 321 AD. That sets the stage for favoring some religion over other religion. The Protestant principle, and Protestants were not always faithful with this, but the Protestant principle is separation of church and state. All right. Same organization, a few days ago, 2nd of March 2017, released a press release entitled European Day for a Work-Free Sunday, Call for Action. This is what they said. Sunday's special and an essential pillar of the European social model. The European Sunday Alliance, therefore, launched today a call to action to show the need for a common European Union-wide regulation members of the European Parliament, the National Sunday Alliances, as well as representatives of labor unions, the churches, and youth organizations reacted already to the call and sent their statements. Together, they agreed that Sunday is of great importance because it allows families to spend time together, employees to rest from their daily work life, and citizens from their daily work life, and citizens to engage in community. There's another organization in Europe called CAMIS, the Commission of Catholic Bishops. And this is what they say about themselves. CAMIS believes that a work-free Sunday is an essential pillar. This is Catholic bishops, remember? Believes that a work-free Sunday is an essential pillar of the European social model. Together with the European Sunday Alliance, we launch a call for action to show the need for a common EU-wide regulation. What's another word for regulation? Law. What kind of law are they calling for? A Sunday law. Now, let me just let you know, they've done this in years before, and it's failed. I don't know whether this will succeed this time around. All I'm trying to demonstrate to you is, what I'm saying the Bible is prophesying as yet future is right on the horizon. In a day of religious toleration, in a day where everyone should worship God according to the dictates of their own conscience, there are groups that have very subtly worded their arguments to sound very humanitarian in nature, you know, defense of the worker and the family and all the rest of it. But ultimately, it's a return to state legislation in favor of church dogma. There's a group in the United States, very similar, called the Lord's Day Alliance. They say on their website, the object of the Lord's Day Alliance of the U.S. is to encourage all people to recognize and observe a day of Sabbath rest and to worship the risen Lord Jesus Christ on the Lord's Day. The LDA, Lord's Day Alliance, is led by, listen carefully, board of managers comprised of clergy and laity from Christian churches and includes persons from Baptist, Catholic, Episcopalian, Friends, Lutheran, Methodist, non-denominationalist, Orthodox, Presbyterian, and Reformed traditions. So what are we saying? We're saying that the Sunday is also positioned as a day of unity between all the churches. In fact, one of the authors, or a man, a Greek Orthodox reverend, had these words to write. He said, in spite of all the challenges that have tugged at the threads of Christian unity, the Lord's Day remains the one unassailable marker of Christian unity. That's straight out of the early Reformation, right? That's straight out of Catholicism's overthrowing of the Counter-Reformation and so on. They all agreed that the Sunday is church tradition, Protestant and Catholic alike, right? So he's saying today, the Sunday, is an unassailable marker of Christian unity, since it is on this day that all of us, despite our many differences, gather together as believers in Christ. What am I saying? I'm saying that Sunday has been positioned today as the humanitarian Sabbath, the one that's good for people and for families. Sunday has been positioned as the Sabbath of ecumenical unity. What does ecumenical mean? It means the coming together of the churches. In the Reformation, there was a breaking away. The purpose of Roman Catholicism's Counter-Reformation, which began with the Council of Trent and has continued through the ages in some very subtle forms and some overt forms, has been to bring the breakaways back into the Mother Church. Sunday is a key catalyst in that mission, an ecumenical Sabbath, overcoming of our barriers, overcoming of our differences, because we all share that church tradition in common, right? And then what we've already established is that Sunday is also the symbol, the Sabbath, of papal authority. That, in essence, is where we are in Earth's history. Now, let me say it again, because I know the skeptic is sitting with us. Prophecy means we're looking at things that have not yet come to pass. I'm trying to show you with contemporary events that the prophecy is not so far-fetched, because things are already happening and being put in place now that are setting the stage for the final fulfillment of this prophetic view. The historical precedent we have is Constantine. I mentioned him. 321 AD, Constantine passed a secular Sunday law. What word did I use? A secular Sunday law. He did not compel Christian worship on a Sunday. He simply created a space and time that created synchronized time off. Does that make sense? And it was only three decades later, in 365 AD, that the Council of Laodicea outright banned Sabbath keeping. So what comes first? The friendly, open to everyone, even if you don't believe, time off for your family, for friendship, for activities other than work. It is promoted as a symbol of freedom. The idea is we're doing a good thing with this legislation. We are doing something that will benefit your family, that will benefit your health. You don't even have to go to church on that day. It's just a great time of synchronized time off. That's what Constantine did. And it was three decades after that that the church then launched its offensive directly at the seventh-day Sabbath. And I'm saying to you, that's where we are today. We're on the verge of the secular Sunday laws that will prepare the way for an all-out assault against God's Ten Commandments, in particular His fourth commandment. But expect history to repeat itself. So those who are looking at it and going, I just can't see how this will ever happen. It will happen in little steps. Does that make sense? And I'm suggesting that history tells us that it'll happen first with a, with what seems to be like a benign, secular, in favor of human beings and family, secular, synchronized time off. And then, later on, the worst will come. So, we're closing off. Sunday sacredness, I'm suggesting to you, is the son born of the marriage between human authority and church tradition. The very core difference that separated Protestant reformers from the Catholic Church in the 1500s. That issue is still with us today. The Reformation still needs to carry on. And Sunday is the very outward symbol of that union of human authority and church tradition. But when you study the Sabbath in Scripture, you realize that the seventh-day Sabbath is the son born of the marriage between divine authority and the Scriptures. And once again, in the last days, the Sabbath will become the point of special contention. So let me leave you with these two statements. Catholic Mirror, 2 September 1893. The Adventists are the only, this is a Catholic source, right? The Adventists are the only body of Christians with the Bible as their teacher who can find no warrant in its pages for the change of day from the seventh to the first. Hence their appellation or their name, Seventh-day Adventists. If this is the first time you're with us today, I understand that this would be a real bombshell for you to walk into for the first time. But you know what Seventh-day Adventist means? Adventist, Advent, means coming. We are looking for the coming of Jesus. If you are looking for the coming of Jesus, you are an Adventist. And if you are convinced that the seventh day, if you're convinced that the seventh day is the true Bible Sabbath and you will make your commitment to stand under the banner of Christ and His commandments, then you have become a Seventh-day Adventist. That's all it means. Right? Last statement. Pastor's page, St. Catherine's Catholic Church Sentinel. 1995. That's not that long ago. People who think that the Scriptures should be the sole authority should logically become Seventh-day Adventists and keep Saturday holy. What I'm illustrating there is that to this day, even Catholicism recognizes the difference between true Protestantism and Catholicism. They're saying, if you believe in the Bible and the Bible alone, the watchword, the phrase of the Protestant Reformation, if you believe that, then there is only one organization, they say, that it makes sense to give your allegiance to or be a part of, and that is a true Protestant denomination called the Seventh-day Adventist Church. That's what the Sabbath means in these last days, friends. That's why we take it seriously. That's why we've spent 4 weeks and we'll spend another week on this. That's why we talk about it all the time. Because we believe that according to the book of Revelation, chapter 14, it is God's special point of reformation for this age in time. He calls us to the worship of the true God, the Creator God. He calls us to worship him with the very symbol that is an acknowledgement of the creation event, which is the seventh day Sabbath. He calls us to stand under his banner of the Ten Commandments. He calls us to acknowledge him and his authority as supreme over all authority. He asks us to take our stand in this time of peace in preparation for a time of persecution. He says to us, I want you to be loyal to me the way I have been loyal to you. I have laid down my life to redeem you. And if you have to lay down your life one day to stand for me, my truth, and my commandments, will you do it? Would you take that stand today? That's what the seventh day Sabbath is about. People make out as if we're just making a big deal about one day that follows the other, and who cares? It's not the day that is the issue. It's what the day represents. They say that the seventh day Sabbath is a symbol of legalism. I say to you, no. The seventh day Sabbath is the symbol of righteousness by faith. It means that I am standing on God and his commandments, and I will do whatever he says. I will go and I will follow him by faith wherever he leads me. That's the definition of faith. And the seventh day Sabbath is that. It is the outward sign of righteousness by faith, obedience by faith. The Sunday, which they say is all about the resurrection of Christ, is all about the true faith. I say, no, it's the other way around. And that's Satan's artful work that he does in every generation. He swaps things around. He makes out as if he's the good guy and God is the bad guy. He makes out as if his Sabbath is the symbol of righteousness by faith and God's Sabbath is the symbol of righteousness by works. No. Think about it. If Sunday is human authority substituted for divine authority, church tradition substituted for the authority of the Word of God, then the first day Sabbath is not about the symbol of faith. It's a symbol of man-made religion. Does that make sense? Which is, in essence, works. When I try and make up my own religion to make me acceptable to God, that is called works. The seventh day Sabbath has nothing to do with that. It is, in fact, just us going, you know what, Lord? You are God. We will do what you say. It's called faith. And when we studied, Ezekiel chapter 20, we discovered exactly that. I have given you my Sabbath as a sign between you and me that you will know that I am the God who sanctifies you, that I am the God. It is by my grace, through my power, that you are recreated in the image of God. And the seventh day Sabbath will remind you of that every time it rolls around. So I want to say to you, if you believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ, if you believe that we are saved by grace through faith, if you see the picture emerging from this teaching on prophecy, as brief as it was, then I'm asking you to make a bold decision today and let nothing get in the way of you rendering obedience and loyalty to the God who created you. I'm asking you, no matter what family tradition you have to break, no matter what church you may be leaving behind, no matter how scary it may be to walk into a new place with new faces and so on and so forth, I'm asking you to do what Revelation chapter 18 verses 1 to 4 asks you to do. Revelation 18 verse 1 to 4, a piece of it simply says, Babylon is fallen. Come out. Do not stay and try and reform. Come out of her, my people. There are God-fearing people that God recognizes as his true followers in every church. That's why he says, my people must come out. And I'm asking you this morning to have the boldness and the courage to come out. Become a reformer. Join the noble stream of the Protestant Reformation. Reject church tradition. Stand only on the Word of God. And become a reformer. Outwardly symbolized with the seventh day Sabbath. That's what I'm asking you today to do. We're going to sing a song. It's an old favorite right out of the Reformation. How great thou art. How great thou art. As you sing this song, I want you to think about the words. I want you to sing it from your heart. And I hope and I pray that the greatness of our God will be what drives you, what motivates you to take your stand on the truth of God's word. Let's sing the song. We'll stand together as we do so.